Well, we've made it down here where Andre's got all the costumes laid out for us. And you actually brought these from storage just so we could see them all, didn't you?
I did. I took it out of storage and brought it here to the house.
That's awesome. It's where do y'all see all this stuff? Now, the one from Canada, you were telling us there's one from Canada that you had to get. And they actually are a Elvis certified costume company.
They are. And they're sanctioned by Elvis Presley Enterprises.
Right.
So you know you're going to get good quality material that's going to last a long time.
Oh, my goodness. We're going to show you this one real quick. So hold on. Oh, my goodness. Now, tell us a little bit about this one.
Well, this is basically pretty much the best recognized Elvis outfit.
Right.
It's the Eagle jumpsuit that Elvis wore during the 73 Aloha concert. And it's an exact duplicate.
And it does have Elvis on the Eagle on the back.
Yes. And, of course, it has the matching cape and the matching belt that goes along with it. All approved by Elvis Presley Enterprises.
Right. Now, how much does this one weigh?
This one's a light one. It probably weighs about 6 pounds, I'd say.
That's still, when you're on stage doing something, carrying 6 pounds is a little challenging sometimes.
Yes. And then you add the belt, and that's a couple extra pounds as well.
Now, the company that did this actually did all the beading for this one, didn't they?
Yes, they did. There's a lot of tedious work involved, and it's very professional.
It looks wonderful. It really does. Well, what's the next thing we have to show people?
Well, the next one, if we're going to go back in time a little bit.
Right.
The next outfit that I have is a black and silver outfit. And this one, the stones on it are all glued down. They're not sewn down.
Oh.
So you have to find the product that's going to have the stones adhere to the material.
Right.
So when you wash the material, it's not going to fall off on you.
Oh, that's right.
And especially, too, with the heat, that if you're doing a show, that it's not going to fall off during the middle of a show, you know, poke somebody in the eye. So we have to watch for that, too. So you have to get good, strong adhesive to make it last a long time.
And this one seems to be doing really well.
Yeah, this one is about, well, I'm going to say 18 years old.
Oh, my goodness. And I don't see any beads missing. So whoever did it did a good job.
I did.
I know. he actually does some of his own costumes. And the neat thing is, you learned how to do this where?
Well, actually, when I was working at the prison, the inmates do a lot of handcraft stuff.
Right.
So they're the ones who taught me how to do this. My mother, who is also a seamstress, taught me some things as well. So the combination of both enabled me to be creative and copy this. Of course, there's no a material pattern to get with this, so the pattern to come up with is all done by pictures.
Oh.
So I have to lay it out and draw it out that way.
And you take pictures of, you look at pictures that Elvis had the jumpsuits on, and then you take that pattern and you recreate it onto a jumpsuit.
Yes, and try to duplicate it. Otherwise, trying to purchase one of these outfits, very expensive.
Now, here's the belt. This belt goes with the one that he's holding up now.
Can you see how it matches all up?
Yeah. Now, the neat thing about this is you did this too, didn't you?
Well, I put the stonework on here.
Yes.
The inmates at the prison made the belts for me themselves.
That's neat. You see the back, they actually did all the leather work. And then he's fixed it. And it just looks wonderful. It's really cool.
Now this jumpsuit, I actually started creating this back around 1993. So that's how old it is, gives you an idea.
Right.
And it weighs, this outfit itself weighs 9 pounds, and the belt weighs 9 pounds. So there's a total of about 18 pounds of wear on all this. And when you start shake, rattling, and rolling around, you're going to sweat a lot.
So this is 18 pounds that you jump around with?
Yes. And it, like I said, you sweat very
well. Do you wear this one very often?
Yes, I do.
I do. Oh, my goodness.
And the back side of it as well is full of beads.
Now this one you did all the beadwork.
I did. It took me a year to make it, and there's approximately 30,000 stones on this whole outfit.
And then you got the legs. You should see the legs here. Now we've got a little clip we're going to show you here in just a minute of the whole outfit, but this is just a close up of the legs. So he has done an amazing job here.
So and there's not too many tribute artists that actually wear these outfits.
Right.
And that's one of the things that intrigued me was everybody recognizes the White Eagle jumpsuit.
Right.
But some others don't wear this, or they may wear the ones that are fringes. So I wanted to capture something that's a little bit more unique.
Right. I think this is beautiful. This is just really cool. So now when you have a state trooper pull you over, you'll have a different image of the man. He's done an amazing job. I don't know if you can see this really well on the camera, but you can in a minute when we show you closer up. But the tedious work that he has done with these beads, you not only when you sew these on, you sew one or two on, you have to turn around and go back and you have to sew in between each bead to hold them down in the strand. And you can't see the thread work. It's just really beautiful. So I'm sure some people appreciate that.
Yes, they do. It makes it all for the realism.
Oh, it does. And this is heavy, I will tell you. I'm holding this for a little while and it's very heavy, so.
And then I have one more outfit that I'm in the current process of making. And it's gonna be another white outfit.
Right.
This
one you just started, right?
I started a long time ago. I just kind of put it aside and trying to get back to it. But there's some upcoming shows that are getting involved, so I want to work diligently, hopefully by next year.
Yes.
For the big concert for next year in August. We'd like to have it done by then. But I've been working on this diligently, and this is a lot more tedious than the previous outfit I just showed you.
I can tell. This one, how many beads do you sew down at a time?
This one, you take 5 stones at a time, and you sew it down, then you come back and loop in between each stone, like you mentioned earlier. So this takes a little bit more time to get it done. But laying out the pattern and coming up with the design, because like I said, there is no pattern to get. You just have to look at pictures and come up with your own.
Right. Now, how many rows of gold is this here? How many rows do you have so far of just the gold?
Well, right there, just that one little spot, there's 5 rows.
5 rows just in that gold right there. So this is, when did you start this part? When did you start this?
Years ago.
Years ago.
But unfortunately, it doesn't take long to do it. I just set it down because of my rest of my activities and my job and stuff. So,
right.
But like I said, I do want to get back to finishing it up. The belt, the matching belt that goes along with this is already done. There's some other parts that goes on the jumpsuit. It's already done. It's just a matter of putting it on, applying it. And then, of course, then I got this part here.
Got this bird to finish, and then you got one more to make.
There's another matching side to it on the other side, and then there's another bird yet to finish for the back side.
So you have 2 more pieces to finish besides this one to put it all together.
Yes.
Wow.
And then you sew it down onto the outfit itself.
Now, when you get it done in a year from now, we'll have to come back and look at it.
Absolutely.
That would be awesome.
We'll be wearing it for the next year's show.
Oh, wow. I just can't believe the work you do. You're very detailed, and I think that comes with being a detective with the state police, that you have that detail-oriented.
Look for the simplest little things and make it work.
And then you turn around and do this. But I don't know if some people notice, this is also kind of therapy for him. You know, when you're working murder cases that take years to solve, this is something he accomplishes every day. He can come to the house and put a few things on here, and he's accomplished something during the day, and then he can turn around and go to the office and try to solve another crime or a murder, whatever it is you've got to do. So he has a little accomplishment during the day. So he's...
Yes. And, well, the other thing that goes along with all this to make all Elvis work is the singing. Everybody knows how to sing. A lot of people sing in the shower.
Yes.
I do sing in the shower sometimes. But at the same time, when you're out there performing Elvis songs, people listen to the music that you're singing.
Yes.
And there are some people, not necessarily Elvis performers, but there are some people that just sing words. But when you sing the songs with feelings and emotions, that comes across to the audience.
Yes, it does.
At the same time, though, if you're singing the songs, the audience is accepting that you might mess up a word or two here and there. But if you don't know the song, people are going to understand that too and realize
that. Right.
So it's very crucial that you know the song. And we'll probably talk about that later on. But when you go up on stage, in my shows, I generally sing about 30 to 40 songs. That's a lot of words to remember to some songs. So we had fun with that. But the audience is forgiving if you mess up a little bit.
I think so. Yeah. I think they would be. But this is just wonderful. You're very detail-oriented to keep it authentic. I think that's the unique thing about Samu. A lot of people call him by Samu, by his last name. But I think it's really neat that he's very detailed and he tries to make it authentic. So when you go to see him as Elvis, you You think you're seeing Elvis.
We try. So, thank you. Yes, we do. Yeah,
that's great. Now, do we have anything else to show them? We have you have your ring, I believe, is what we were going
to... Oh, yes. Yeah? Yes. I'll have to go get that.
So, well, we're gonna wait for him to go get the ring, and we're going to look at that. And then he's got some other memorabilia back here that's really intriguing. So come go with us. Now, Nick.
Andrew Locus
gave you a ring that's really special to you. What was that for?
It is. Nick gave me this ring, and what it is a token of the next generation. Can you see that right there? Next generation of Elvis, tribute artist, or appreciation for Elvis, in that Elvis handed out a necklace, a TCB necklace, to his constituents and the people that he liked and stuff. Right. And so Nick, in honor of what I was carrying on as a legacy for Elvis, basically accepted me into the fold with the other Elvis people in Elvis's life. And so Nick had this ring made up for me, especially for me. So it's a one-of-a-kind ring. And in that, it's a gold ring, oval shape on top, as you can see.
Right.
And then it has a TCB with a diamond inlay on that as well. And so this is kept at a local bank in a safe. I don't want nothing to happen to this.
No, that's a special gift. Now, for those people that are younger than we are and don't know who Nick is, tell them who Nick is.
Well, if you go to the airport, if you go to Graceland and look at the Lisa Marie jet that Elvis flew around in, Elvis would fly from Memphis to Denver to get Nick's sandwiches. Nick made the peanut butter, jelly, and bacon sandwiches, whereas Elvis was used to growing up with Elvis peanut butter, jelly, and banana sandwiches. Bananas were very prominent back in the South there. So Elvis fell in love with the situation. Nick ended up making the sandwiches for Elvis. And so Nick became very famous for that.
Right.
And so he has a little place out there called Nick's Cafe where everybody that knows Elvis, everybody that appreciates Elvis, goes and sees him. So that was a unique thing, and that's how. So if you go to Graceland, go to the airport, you'll see the story behind all this.
Right.
Very well famous.
It's beautiful. And you wear this during your concerts that you do.
On special concerts, yes,
special
I'll wear it.
Special concerts, mm-hmm. That's cool. Now we have a few more things to show you.
Well, we're here in the hallway where he's got some of the pictures that have been sent to him or people have signed, and he's going to tell you a little bit about these. These are special pictures. Now, what's your most favorite one? Now, before we get to this, I'm going to step out of the way so you can see what he's doing here. So show us your special one.
Okay, thank you. This picture here is, of course, a picture of Elvis with Joe Esposito. Joe was Elvis's road manager. And when I did the concert at Morehead University a few years ago, Joe came out because we was doing a benefit concert for his wife who was suffering and later died from cancer. So he came out, and as appreciation for that, he signed this picture for me and gave that to me ahead of time. Of course, it's dated 2011. And so the unique thing about that is Joe Esposito actually stayed at our house. And that's another, I guess, big thing in my life that I appreciate as far as authenticity goes and appreciation. So he did that. The other picture up here is, I'll remove this one picture, but this is a picture of Bobby Petrofesso and Elvis. Like I said, Elvis went to Denver a lot. And Bobby was a narcotics officer for the Denver Police Department. And so this check here represents a copy of Elvis purchasing a truck for Bobby Petrofesso. Bobby is a dear friend of mine, and we've become acquainted. And of course, and as time passes, we all change just a little bit. And this is a picture of Bobby now, as time's gone by. But Bobby, what his job was for Elvis when Elvis did do concerts in Denver, was to hold the curtain open for Elvis. And there was one moment in time when Bobby and Elvis were at the stage getting ready to come out for the performance, and Elvis asked Bobby if he's nervous. And Bobby says, I'm not nervous. I'm not the one going out there to sing in front of all these people. You are. So that kind of lightened the moment for both of them and said, had a good time. And then there's some others. This picture, what this represents is, this was given to me at a concert, that specific concert where Jerry Kennedy gave me the badge the day after. This was a concert that I had went to. And this is Bobby Petrofesso again. And then this is Nick Androulakis, who made Elvis's sandwiches. And so what happened was they came to the show, And they made a presentation to me of the group that watched over Elvis. And of course, it's here with Jerry Kennedy, Ron Petrofesso, Bobby's brother, Bobby Petrofesso, Robert Cantwell. Real quick about Robert, he was one of the detectives for the police department, ended up being the commissioner or the executive director for the prisons out in Colorado. And he had come to the prison where I was working at, and we had walked up the walkway to the prison one day, and he says, so I hear you have a pink Cadillac. And I said, well, yes, I do. I had a 58 pink Cadillac. And he says, well, I got the real thing. And he jingles out his keys, and Elvis gave him a Cadillac like he did many other people. And then there's a bunch of others as well, too. But this was given to me for the concert that I did on September 2011. And again, it's an honor to be recognized by those people that cherished Elvis as much, knowing that what my appreciation for Elvis and the legacy we try to create for others as well. So they gave me this presentation, this plaque, and I appreciate that. Yeah, the other thing we talked about before about Jerry Kennedy, and he was a captain at the time with the Denver Police Department, and he ended up being the chief of police at Denver.
Right.
Well, Elvis was a very badge collector, known for that. And so Jerry gave Elvis his lieutenant's badge. Well, after one of my concerts that I did, Jerry called me up and said, I want you to meet me at Nick's for breakfast. So we go to Nick's for breakfast, and after we get done with the conversation, Jerry pulls in his pocket and hands me this badge. This badge is his very first badge. And I'll put it up to the camera so you can see there.
Yeah.
And the numbers on it is 57-26.
Right.
And what that represents is the 57 is the year that Jerry Kennedy graduated from the academy. There was two classes that year. And so the first class had cadets from 1 through 25. And then the second one was 26 through 50. Well, this badge is 57-26, which represents that Jerry was the first person to the honorary in his class, even though it was a second class.
Right.
So that's how that distinguishes that. So I told him that I didn't want this because this is a family heirloom that should be kept by the family.
Right.
But he insisted I have it because of the representation that we've done towards Elvis and the legacy of Elvis.
I think this goes back to what we were talking about earlier, is the authenticity that he does. You don't just sing a few of Elvis's songs. You don't just wear his jumpsuit. You become Elvis when you put this on. You are very authentic when you're playing Elvis.
We try to be. My theory has been that if you're going to portray Elvis, and especially for me, for, as you pointed out, detail-orientated, I want you to walk away from our shows to say, this is the closest to Elvis that we're going to get.
It's the closest you're going to get, so. Well, this is great. Now, some of the things that you do are your nonprofit organizations. And with those nonprofit things, you actually go and you do a concert for them, or some people pay you to come and do those concerts for those. And that's what's dearest to your heart, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Because obviously I'm not going to make any money doing this, but we do raise a lot of money for the local charities.
Right.
And whether it's you sing to one person or you sing to a multitude of people, it's all for the cause of a specific organization that I get invited to. And that's the treat. For me, the payoff is to see the glimmer in somebody's eyes that appreciates the music.
What's the largest crowd you've sung to?
About 5,000 people.
Would that make you a little bit nervous?
Every show, whether it's 25 people, I'm still nervous.
You're nervous whether it's 5 or 25?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. Now, is there any way people can contact you in order to have you sing at their event? Or
they can call. I'll put it out there. I'll give them my personal cell phone number, and that's 859-398-8668. And when you call that number, you'll be talking to me. And we have an upcoming concert that I'm inviting everybody to. It's going to be on October 15th, 2015 at the City Place in LaGrange. The concert is going to benefit the Kentucky State Police Shop with a Trooper program for the kids and also for the Crisis Pregnancy Center in LaGrange. So we welcome everybody to come out there. The tickets are $20 in advance. You call my cell phone number. We'll make arrangements about the transaction, about the cost and the tickets. And then if you want to wait until get them at the door, they're $25 at the door. And there's no special seating. Everybody just first come, first serve.
Well,
This is great that you've been with us. I really appreciate this. And I appreciate everything that you do. This is great that you give back to the community the way you do.
Well, thank you very much for having me. Appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome. So we're going to check back in with him again at another time. And we're going to check out the outfit that he's making. Hopefully it'll be done before the year's up.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And as always, thank you for watching.